Welcome back. Naglaro na nga para sa Cleveland Cavaliers ang bagong all-star point guard nilang si Isaiah Thomas, pero bakit parang nag-regress naman ang laro ng Cavs? At hindi lang sa opensa ang problema ng Cleveland, pati ang depensa nila, inaabuso na ng ibang mga koponan. Is it time for another big trade para mabuhayan ang kampanya ng Cleveland? Well, let's talk to the hoop nut. Enzo Flojo is back on the score. Enzo, welcome back.
Hey, Teeds.
All right. Well, para sa Cleveland fans, hindi happy new year.
It's been ugly.
Na-excite sila nung bumalik si Isaiah Thomas. Yeah. He had a good start in his
first game.
Second
points,
game, pumutok
yeah.
din talaga.
19 points, yeah.
I think those are the two games they won.
Yes.
And then that's two kasama dun sa tatlo that they won in the last 10.
Yes.
So they're 3-7 in the last 10
in the
games.
Last 10 games.
And ends the losses have been ugly. So and, anong yeah. impression mo sa mga kaganapan sa Cleveland ngayon?
Well, I think you hit the nail right on the head, Teach. Defense has been a very big problem for this team. Mm. I mean, they rank in the bottom 10 of the entire league in all the major defensive stat categories, blocks, rebounds, steals, and defensive efficiency also. So yun talaga yung main problem ng Cleveland right now. And I think they're still trying to figure things out as a team defensively, what they want to do.
Okay.
Because the entry of Isaiah Thomas affects not just their offense, although he's known mainly for their offense, for his offense, but it affects him defensively as well. Kasi prior to Thomas coming in with Cleveland, you know, having some measure of success after a slow start to the season, with the lineup na may LeBron James ka, may Jay Crowder, may Tristan Thompson ka, with J.R. Smith ka, you can pretty much switch everything on defense. Now with Thomas coming in, let's make Kevin Love ka pa, who's not exactly the best defender, defender. Biglang may not one but two liabilities on defense for Cleveland. And yun yung medyo palaisipan for Coach Ty Lue right now.
So yun yung challenge sa kanya. And even, I mean, this is not a secret. This was also the liability that Thomas had when he was in Boston.
But the thing
is, Boston had a very good defensive system na nakakapagtulong sila, nagtutulungan sila. Yeah. And, you know, they were able to fix that as a flaw and still even it out as his advantage on offense. Okay. Is this what it is? Is it the growing pains with a new Isaiah, a point guard in Isaiah Thomas that initially they were supposed to play him parang 12 to 19 minutes? That wasn't followed through pretty much. Namagana 20, 25, 26, diba? Is that really the problem? Is it an Isaiah Thomas thing? Or with his entry, it actually highlighted what problems actually were underlying na lalong lumala lang siguro?
I think lalong lumala, again, yung defensive impotency, so to speak, in Cleveland. I mean, even when they won the championship 2 seasons ago, defense was really their Achilles heel.
Yeah.
That was highlighted last year when they got Kyle Korver, who was a good shooter, but defensively, because of his age, hindi na siya makasabay masyado. And you compound that even more this season with you know, the addition of Isaiah Thomas. So their defense takes a hit, definitely. And that's something a lot of people expected anyway. But what people also expected was, sige, they're going to be bad on defense, but they're going to be extra brilliant on offense. But the fact is, the past 2 games at least, against Toronto and against Minnesota, that just hasn't happened.
Correct.
So defensively, the last 3 games, they've allowed 127 points at least in each of those games. They were able to outscore Orlando, which is a bad defensive team, but against Minnesota and Toronto nga kanina, talagang yung mga chinks in the armor ng Cleveland, it began to show. And I think the ball right now, so to speak, is in Ty Lue's court. Because as you said, Teej, in Boston, Isaiah Thomas was part of a pretty tight defensive system.
Correct.
So even if, you know, opposing players tried to take advantage of his size, they still could be able to make things work. Here in Cleveland, the pressure is on Ty Lue to try and think of a way to incorporate Thomas and Kevin Love and make a good system where both of those guys can still work.
Well, in the offseason, when they were making their moves, you know, part of this trade that bringing Isaiah Thomas over was Jay Crowder.
Yeah.
A renowned defensive specialist, you know, and a good corner three-point shooter as well. And yung pagdagdag din na veterano si Jeff Green, who's actually had some good moments this season. I can't think of anybody else that's new that has supposed to be, you know, from their rookie sila Osman or whatnot. No, parang silang dalawa yung medyo tinitignan na kahit papaano.
May major
should
impact
help them defensively.
What have you
seen from these two guys?
Well, they're solid defenders individually, but the thing that we saw earlier today against Toronto was Jay Crowder. He's good defending wings, but against guys like Jonas Valanciunas, guys who are bigger than him, even that Van Vliet fellow, he had a very, very tough time. And remember that, you know, Jay Crowder is built to defend guys like Carmelo Anthony and LeBron James, you know, big muscular guys who play in the wings.
Yeah.
But if you put him down low against much bigger opposition, he's going to struggle.
He's
and that's what we saw today against Toronto.
All right. Well, first things first, they have a back-to-back schedule. They're playing tomorrow morning, Manila time. Indiana Pacers, who had some recent success.
Even in their losses,
they've been very competitive with Lance Stephenson turning back the clock and Victor Oladipo playing like an all-star, which he probably will be. How challenging will this be? LeBron does not like losing three straight games.
He does not like losing blowouts.
Ito na nga, parang there was a weird stat in the first time that LeBron had back-to-back 25-point losses in his time in Cleveland.
It's been really bad.
How urgent is it for them to do well? Maybe if they lose at least, maybe lose competitively.
For me right now, I think, you know, if I were a big Cleveland fan, if I had a panic meter, 1 to 10, 10 being the most panic, I'd still peg them maybe at 3.
Okay.
But if they lose against Indiana, and if this extends to maybe 4 or 5 games, a slump, then that panic meter could dial up to maybe a 7 or an 8. Because at this juncture...
So one game can make it swing. Yeah.
Because if you're the management of the Cleveland Cavaliers, you're beginning to think, okay, back-to-back bad losses... Okay, pa.
Yeah.
If we lose against Indiana, but it's a competitive loss, I can take that. Mm. But if it extends to a 5-game losing slump and the trade deadline is looming closer and closer, then that, you know, that's going to play around with my decision making as a manager for the Cleveland Cavaliers.
Okay. Well, when you mentioned the trade deadline, it is coming up. It's earlier than what it was before, no? Dahil gusto nga nila iwasan yung awkwardness ng All-Star. DeAndre Jordan is a name that's a buzz, potentially available to move, but we don't know, you know, what kind of pieces should they offer to try to get somebody like that if they want to get that defensive presence, that rim protection, and at least, you know, at least his offensive game is inside. You can throw the lobs into him. Pero sulit ba yun para sa kanila?
Well, ako, at the beginning of the season, I was telling a lot of people na Cleveland will probably make a play for a big man you know, before the trade deadline. Yeah. I was telling a lot of people it could be DeMarcus Cousins. Mm-hmm. Right now, the noisy name is, like what you said, Teach, DeAndre Jordan. I think he fills in some gaps on defense. Mm-hmm. And he's the kind of guy who, offensively, he won't look for his own shot.
Yep.
He's going to make things work. He's going to make LeBron happy with all those assists.
Yeah.
Two DJs, that's going to make the numbers of LeBron better, maybe for Isaiah Thomas also. So I think on paper, he's a good fit.
Yeah.
But the risk you take if you're Cleveland is Isaiah Thomas just came back to the team, and you're adjusting to that. And then before the trade deadline, another significant piece that will force you to adjust to another stage of adjustment. The thing with Cleveland, what we've seen from them the past 3 or 4 seasons is every time they go through that stage of adjustment, they really, really struggle.
Yep.
And I'm not sure if they can afford that late in the season. Okay. Right now, they're on pace for about 52, 53 wins. Mm-hmm. If they continue to struggle by the end of January, that estimate could go down to maybe 48, 47 wins. Things could get a little too dangerous for Cleveland.
The Miami Heat are only two, three games behind them.
And they're streaking.
Yeah, and they're streaking. The former team of LeBron and Dwayne Wade, without the superstar power, they're doing well. But can they afford this DeAndre trade, if ever? I mean, and to make a trade, will it have to be that Brooklyn pick? Which, by the way, if you're monitoring Cleveland fans, Brooklyn is 12th. They're not dead last, as what the Cleveland fans
are
hoping.
So all of a sudden, it's not as juicy as it was.
But they're not so far. They're 50-26. Well, the worst in the East is Atlanta at 11-30. So they're 4 wins away. But is it that going to be have to be that lucrative? Does it have to be the Brooklyn pick and maybe throw in, like, I don't know, Tristan Thompson or something to get a big man?
I think there are two options for Cleveland right now. You roll the dice by trading a big name. And the biggest name that, you know, everyone's been always talking about as a tradable guy is Kevin Love. The other option is exactly what you said, Deej. Trade a mid-level guy, a Tristan Thompson, maybe slap in a Kyle Korver, something like that. And then, you know, you spice it up with that Brooklyn pick. Yeah. And those are the two options that they can go with if they want to get a big-name guy by the trade deadline. Those are the only two ways they can do that.
As much as you said, the onus is right now on Ty Lue to try to figure things out.
Yeah, for sure.
How much of it, though, lies on LeBron James as the leader as well? I mean, you know, he's the coach on the floor as well. Yeah. He runs his team pretty much. The critics like to say he is the coach. But how much is it on him that he has to at least get the giggle out on the court? You know, it's one thing to have the X's and O's.
Yes.
It's another thing to motivate your guys and say, guys, we got to put the effort in there, because defense, you know, arguably is 80% effort, and the rest is really strategizing what is to be done.
Well, I think, in fairness to LeBron, I think he's doing, you know, as much as he can on the floor. Mm-hmm. It's just that I think they've been adjusting to each other's styles of play. Remember that Isaiah Thomas, the moment he came in, the number of shots of everyone else went down. I mean,
labasan, yeah.
Pre-Isaiah Thomas this season, Kevin Love was averaging about 13 field goal attempts per game. Uh-huh. After Isaiah Thomas came in, that number dropped down to about 9 to 10 attempts per game. Mm-hmm. So it's really not LeBron himself. I think it's more of the players around him. I mean, mm-hmm. just the other night against Minnesota, he was negative 39.
See LeBron.
Yeah. And that's, I think, the first time in his career. But for me, that doesn't speak about how poorly he played. I think it's the players around him mm-hmm. who shot very, very poorly.
Yeah.
And that affected his plus-minus on the court.
Correct. Ganun yun. With the way he plays,
yes.
he needs the shooters to hit, to space things out for him to be truly effective. Okay, so where do they go from here? As you said, the Indiana game tomorrow, which, by the way, you can watch it on NBA Sabados on Channel 2. It could be a big pendulum swing of the panic meter. But beyond that, ilang araw na lang ba ang trade deadline para sa kanila?
Gosh, I think a couple of weeks, I think.
Okay.
So, konti na lang.
Kasi All-Star is a month away.
Yeah,
and it's,
yeah,
I know it's earlier than All-Star
this
time around. Okay.
So, for Cleveland, I think it's not really a must-win yet for mm-hmm. Indiana, but it's a must-be competitive game.
Yun, at least.
Yes.
Magpakita kayo ng competitive drive.
And a lot of people will say, LeBron doesn't really care about the regular season.
Yep.
Maybe that's true to a certain extent, mm-hmm. but you still want to get as much momentum as you can heading into that playoff, to the playoffs. And with teams like Toronto on the rise, doing well, Miami creeping up as well, Washington's always there, mm-hmm. you don't know what's going to happen in the East.
And by the way, after Indiana, they're playing the Warriors.
Yun lang.
The Magic.
Yun lang.
The Thunder, who are struggling, and then the Spurs. So it's
going to be easy.
Interesting stretch para sa Cleveland Cavaliers the next five games. Right, Enzo, maraming salamat. See you again soon. Thank you.
For more sports updates, keep watching The Score. And don't forget to subscribe.